Okay, so let's start. My name is Juande Carrion. I'm a software architect in Lidl Digital. I have around 10 years experience. I was working in the Czech Republic for around 5 years, 3 years in Brno, then in Prague. The last 5 years I have spent in Germany, and mainly focused in the last 6-7 years in e-commerce. Okay. The company I work for, it's well known for its supermarkets. Okay. They have it's a discounter. But what many people don't know is that we also run many online shops, and that it's also a very important part of our business, also as a part of our strategy. This company, Lidl, belongs to this group. Okay, it belongs to the Schwarzgruppe. It's a company that runs the Lidl group, the supermarkets, the online part, Kaufland. Kaufland has also a few projects in this e-commerce area, and it's quite big. Like it's like around the size of Amazon worldwide. It's like depending which numbers you look at, it's like the fourth or the fifth biggest retailer group in the world. Okay. What we do on the online part, it's the online shops. We have also a website where we sell travel packages. You can book a hotel, you can book plane tickets, you can book it all together. We have also like some small areas that work kind of independent inside our non-food online shop, for example, to sell wine and some alcohol. So we have also some things also in the area like of food, because it fits also to the business. Something like you can order like some packages, and then they sell you like some food to cook, like for the weekend, or with all the ingredients, the receipt, the paper. We have also something to send flowers online. Not very profitable, but they love it because they think that we are bending the customer with that. Something to print your photos on a cap, on a poster, and then like a number of services that we try as a like proof of concept, and if it works, then we develop it further. Around like in this e-commerce part, like if when we count everybody working in IT, logistic, in the warehouses, so we have around 2,500 people. We have in the part of the IT, we have 5 locations. In Germany, we have offices in Neckarsulm, south of Germany, close to Stuttgart, and in Berlin. We have also an office in Barcelona, very international, and 2 more offices in Sofia and Bucharest. Okay, this means that when we are developing something, when we have a project or a team, the team is usually split across all the locations. Okay, in reality, it's even bigger because it may be also that we work with some external partners for some particular topic, and then they have different locations, but it works very well so far. This is a little bit like to show you how the warehouses are structured. This is also very important to understand the business of Lidl. So Lidl is a discounter. We sell products online very cheap. The profit margin is very little, so we try to do as much as we can by ourselves. So that means like running of our warehouses, but also running our own infrastructure in our data center, because everything that we can save for every order, for every product that we sell, then it's something that we can invest in the future. If we were trying to outsource everything, it wouldn't work because we are not like a different kind of brand that can have like a big merch like Apple, okay? In Apple, like if they lose like 1 euro per product, they don't care, okay? But in our case, it's very important. And this affects also the way we operate our software, the way we develop our software, and also what we are running in production. Right now, we have around 30,000 products. They are being sold simultaneously in several countries, in Germany, in the Czech Republic, in Belgium, in Netherlands, and there are more, and also in Spain. And there are more online shops to come. We have around 8 million customers already. This is the revenue that we have at the moment per year, but this is also incrementing very rapidly. And this is how we started. Okay, so this was our online shop with the current design. So this is something that we started developing like around 10 years ago, and it has been growing. At the beginning, 10 years ago, nobody knew if Leader was going to be accepted as an online platform. So that's why we started very small. We started with a very small team. We didn't want to invest so much money. And we started with a small application like self-develop that let us grow until now. But the problem that we were facing with the time is that when we want to move faster, to try new things, to run A/B test experiments, or to implement new features to catch up with this online sector that is very dynamic, it's difficult to scale like this monolith to one team, okay? One team works amazingly. You don't have almost overhead, but the problem is when you go, when you try to grow. Right now, this is what we have for the setup with the development. So we have around five locations that are contributing with developers, business analysts, and other roles. We have around 20 teams to develop all our software platforms. And at some point, we noticed that it wasn't working. So the main pain points were like we also tried with a out of the box product, some commercial solution to make the rollout faster in every country. It was some SAP product, and there we had like four teams, and then we noticed like, hey, it doesn't work. Like when you have a big code base and you have four teams, you are all the time like having a lot of overhead, a lot of discussions to implement something. It has to go through many people. You need a lot of release management. And then we try to make a break with what we had before, and then we call this project Mindshift. Okay, Mindshift is it's not only the software that comes out of that. When we talk about Mindshift, it's also the new structure that comes out of that. So this structure, this organization, with people, this new way of working, where we have a smaller unit focused with a concrete purpose, and improving some part of this platform. This is what we usually have when we have a monolith. A monolith, as I said before, it's great when you have only one team. The struggle comes when you have more than one team. If you do it properly, you will have an e-commerce monolith divided in these layers, and you have a front end, you have back end, you have a database. Inside these layers, you can also identify the different domains. If it was properly done, if you had like proper developers, so they have structured the software in components, and these components are grouped in domains. One domain might be the product handling, okay? One subdomain of this product handle can be the price or can be the availability. So even if it's a monolith and it's a big application, you can see these domains and these components. This would be the splitting layers. This is somehow how we split so far the development of the online shops until we started with this project. So basically we had a team with front-end developers was working very close to the business department, and they made some HTML mockups, and then they just throw it to the back-end developers, and then they integrate it with the business requirements to implement it. This was working when we were small. At some point, it didn't work so well anymore. When we think about microservices, so many people think about the back-end, okay? The backend is very easy. You can have for your whole application, you can have, for example, a service for the product, or even a smaller for the availability, for the stock. You can have a backend service only for the search. We have seen it many times. Actually, we started like this long time ago. Like there were pieces that were not so easy to run with a monolith or with the database. So then we started creating some stock service where you were handling that in real time, and then it was integrated to the monolith, but a separated thing. What we have seen discussed many times is like to have some kind of aggregation layer, some backend for frontends, and then to have a single page application or some repo where you have the whole frontend. Okay, this can work. Okay, as everything has advantages and disadvantages. The problem is that if you want to implement some feature in the product or in the search, you probably have to touch two different repos. You need to coordinate that with two teams. So this is the problem that it looks good in the backend, but it doesn't look so good on the frontend. So what we can do is to split this big monolith in these domains, okay, the whole thing. And then one of these vertical domains will contain all the layers that we had until now. It will have the frontend, the backend, the database, and it will contain all these components that are required for this business domain. If we make this split, then even if you have the frontend and the backend together, like you have very focused teams. You have a team that is very focused on the product. Okay, what is important for this team? For this team, it's important that when the customer finds a product, it doesn't matter how he found the product, if it was like through some external referrer or if it was through the search or some campaign, some landing page. What is important for us is that the customer finds all the information that he needs to assess if he wants to buy the product or not. Okay, of course we want to sell the product, but we want also to show the customer as much information as he need to reduce the return. Okay, when you buy something online, you can always return it. According to the law, I think it's similar in the whole European Union, and this is quite important, for example, for wine. Okay, so for wine across the whole industry, like the supermarkets, they throw away around 10% of the wine. This is like this is crazy. So this is thing that they didn't handle well in the warehouse, or they didn't coordinate well to sell it, and then it got spoiled. In the case of e-commerce, from our experience, like 6%. And when they return the bottle, so you cannot sell it, yeah, because you cannot make sure that it wasn't manipulated, so you need to destroy it. And this, with mold, it's even worse. Yeah, with molds, like there are some big players like Zalando. They claim that 40-50% of whatever they sell, it's returned back. Okay? So if you can improve this product detail page, so that the customers are sure that this is what they want, if they can have high quality pictures, if they can know that it's the right size, then you are also making a favor to the customer and to the business. For the search, it's a different mission. The mission that you have is like, you have something in mind, and then you want to find it. And then you need to work also with different technologies. So the technologies that can help you with on this vertical are very different than what you have on the search. In the search, you need to know how a search engine works. You need to know what can you do with the text, which attributes can you extract from the text, and then show it later on the search. In the checkout, is also different. On the checkout, what you want to do is like to make it pleasant, to make it fast for the customer to go through the checkout and enter all the data that we need to ship the products. And then you have very different business requirements. What we gain doing this is not only that we can scale with the software, that we can scale with the organization, it's also that you get teams, and then you have the business and you have the developers that are very focused in one particular domain, and they can deliver the best user experience and features to our users. Another advantage is that if you divide that in this smaller domain, so you know how many resources you need on the infrastructure. So you could have an OpenShift cluster And then you could say, okay, so for the product detail, I need that many instances of the front end because I have some campaign going on. I need that many resources, these three resources for the backend, but maybe I just need one instance of our database. For other applications, it might be different. It might be like, okay, for the search, I have the most of the rendering done on the client side, not that much done on the server. And then we will have only one instance of the front end and then three of the back end, because this is where I need more CPU. The same for rating, the same for every vertical. This applies for resources in our data center as for developers, okay? So you can have more developers for one particular topic where you want to invest, where you want to grow because you know that it's not working that well, and then you can have less resources for another. One thing that we are aware that it's slowing us down is like when you look at the numbers of internet companies, so you see that because of the infrastructure and the culture and many other factors, they are able to deliver things to production very fast. And this enables not only like to deliver something that somebody thinks that it might work, but also to do A-B testing. A-B testing means that I want to test a new feature, I want to test something new, and then I run an experiment with one subset of my users, for example 1%, and then 1% gets to be shown the new feature and to use this new feature, and the other 1% that I have as a like a control group gets the regular feature. If I'm able to deliver that to production easily without any big pain, then I'm able to test more things, I'm able to drive the development of my application through data. And this is something that Facebook, Amazon do very well. There are other big players, for example, Otto, a big e-commerce player, that is also doing okay for the size. This is where we are a little bit behind, okay? We are a little bit behind because of this monolith, because we have so many people working on this piece of code, because we have parts of manual QA, and this was also a reason to divide, split the application in this self-contained system, microservices, and enable this experimentation. The customers at the end, like when they want to visit a page, they are not only interested on the part of the product, they want also to have the navigation, they want to also be able to add the product to the basket. It's not that you have a page and the page is only one vertical. It's a little bit more complex. For example, in this case, we can see that there are different verticals. So one would be the product information, the product vertical. Another one would be the part of the checkout, because here is where the checkout really starts, when you add a product to the basket. We can see there on the top also the mini basket icon. This is also a part that is provided from the checkout vertical because they have this information. And then we have another fragment that comes from the search, okay? So this is one of the things that derive from this splitting in these domains. Here, one thing that we are striving for is that we don't force the teams to commit to any technology, okay? So we want to be more agile. We want that every team decides what are the best technologies that solve the business domain problems, okay? In this case, in theory, we could have an application for the team product running in Vue. We could say that the search is Angular, and that, for example, the team checkout works with React. That would be possible, because at the end, like what we see on the browser, it's only a DOM object, and you can combine DOM and have different applications with their own HTML, CSS, JavaScript. How we are going from one place to another? So we have to remember that this platform was running for around, it was developed for around 10 years. So you have 10 years of a huge team implementing new features and a business department like trying new things. So how can you shift from one thing to another without like taking so much time? One of the ways we are doing that is incremental integration. So we are not waiting until we replace the whole thing to go live with everything. So the approach that we took is like we want to try our things as soon as we can. So we thought at the beginning, okay, what is the smaller domain that we can take online? In this case, it was the rating. So we make a small proof of concept, and after a few months, it was live, okay? I will show you later how this is integrated. Right now, we have gone live with several verticals. So the navigation for the header and the footer is live, the rating, the product, and now comes the search, the checkout. So we are doing quite well. It's quite a lot of effort at the beginning to take the first piece of this application online, but then it's very easy because it's loosely coupled. So you can deploy it independently. At the moment, we have 10 teams working on 10 different domains. This was also quite challenging because we were used to have developers that know the software very well, that know the business domain very well. And now we started with new teams. We had a lack in some teams. We have people that were with us quite long, and they know like the business domain. They know how it was implemented before. In other cases, it's people that need a little bit of time to ramp up because they don't know the business requirements, so it takes a little bit longer time to do that. But in general, they are doing a great job. About the team responsibility is something that we are shifting. Before you had a different setup. You had people that were specialized on the front end, and they were doing the front end for all these domains. You had people that were focused, for example, from the business domain, they were focused on the A/B testing, and they were doing the A/B testing for everything. Now, when in every of these 10 teams, we have everything that we need to develop this independently from other teams. That means that we have a product owner. He's the one that has the say about what to implement and when. We have also front-end developers, back-end developers, and then people that can integrate that in our infrastructure. Okay, so it can be a developer with some experience in DevOps. So it's quite simple, actually. This is a little bit our infrastructure. So we have a likely SAP phase on the backend. The focus of Mindshift would be this part that is facing the customer, the shop systems. Once we get the order confirmation for an order, then it goes to SAP and then we forget. So this is more or less what we do. Here is a high level diagram of the software artifacts that we have. So we see here that we have a part of the backend systems to maintain, for example, the product information, the stock, the pricing. We have the CMS to add, for example, landing pages or to maintain the navigation. And then they are like all these arrows that you see here are asynchronously. Okay, so we don't have any synchronous call when we are running the software in order to render a particular fragment on the front end. So you will talk only to this piece of software that you have in your own vertical. The rest of the data that you need to render that comes asynchronously. So these are like the CMS backend systems are applications that only our internal users see. And in this column, you have all the verticals, all the applications that our customers are facing. So at the end, they are integrated in some integration layer. We use for that Vanish. We could have used Nginx or something like this. And and then the page is returned to the customer. Okay, so this is somehow the loop. So we get information about the product, we maintain the navigation, the landing page, the content, and then once the user has bought something, then the checkout generates an order, and the order is passed through SAP. We have gone with this microservice approach, but we are not like trying to make these parts as small as possible. So for example, for the checkout, we started only with one thing for that, and then we created a single page application for the whole checkout. Right now, we divided this team, and we have four teams that are gonna be working in different domains, for example, order management, customer data management, like address, the basket, and then we need to split these applications. But in other parts, so we are, it's already losing support, okay? So every application that you see here, the product detail, the rating, the search, the recommendation, the search service, they are all like totally independent of the other, so you can run them on the computer and then it will render this fragment of the page, and the data will be distributed through a message broker. Okay, in this case we are using RabbitMQ. There are some use cases where we think that it makes sense to use Apache Kafka, but right now it's RabbitMQ in all these places. We still have some ugly places from our legacy systems. For example, here in these verticals, we still have a shared DB, but we are addressing the topic and thinking like how to split it further between the CMS, the navigation part, and the content pages. In order to migrate the data, so we are not doing a clone of what we had before. So what we are doing is like every domain has its own database structure. When I say database, it doesn't have to be a relational database. It depends on the domain. In some parts, we have a very simple key value storage with Redis. We don't need to persist the data. We can always collect the data from the other verticals. In other verticals, we have a search engine running out of that, something like Elasticsearch. Others require a little bit more of data integrity, and then we have a little bit of relational database. It depends on the domain, but what we do is like we are doing this migration per domain, okay? We are going away from this big database schema and have this divided. OpenShift is one tool that we are hoping is gonna take us further in order to maintain the infrastructure, in order to give the developers more autonomy. I don't think I have to explain you what OpenShift is. So this is something that we don't have in place yet. We are finalizing that, but we hope that in March we can go live using OpenShift. So far we are doing that using Docker Compose on virtual machines. It works, but in a few months we will start using OpenShift in production. This is some snippet how it looks, the integration. So this would be, for example, what you see here is a part of the product detail page. So on the product detail page, you want to render the header. So in order to render the header, the only thing that you need to do is this edge-side include. It's like a server-side include, where you say that that you want to render this piece of HTML coming from the navigation vertical. And then Varnish will take care of that under the hood, okay? It's a very simple thing. You need to have a little bit of discipline. For example, to have in these fragments, to have the proper CSS, like self-contained, the JavaScript, the CSS have to be invocated in reference, at least in the HTML. But once you wrap your mind around that, it's very easy to continue. The reason why we're using edge-side includes and not a single page application is that for us, for our business, the SEO is very important. It's very important for us that the products that are well positioned on the internet, that they get a hit when you look for example, when you look for a bed or a mattress, you get it in Germany some results from Lidl there. This is very important, and this is why we cannot do just rendering on the browser. And this push us to use this HID include. But at the end, it's very nice because, like, if you look at this code, the vertical that is including the others know nothing about the technology. So you don't care if it's Angular, you don't care if it's React, you don't care if it's PHP or Java or Go. You just have an endpoint, you include it, and then you forget. Other options would be to use Ajax, so we can always use Ajax, retrieve some fragment from some endpoint and then add it to the DOM. Another option would be to share the state, for example, for the basket or for things that are related to the customer session on the browser, and then have a little bit of DOM manipulation to add this so that you don't have to do this ping pong going to the server to render this information. Another thing that works very well is to share web components using NPM. So what we do is like, for example, we, on one vertical, on the product vertical, we have a component to render a product grid box. This component will be exported using NPM. It will be stored in our Artifactory or Nexus, and then it will be imported from other verticals like the search to be rendered later altogether. This might be a problem if this NPM component requires some synchronous call because you can have a timeout. You can make your page slower when you are waiting for other pieces of software. You can have a problem if there is some issue with the network. But this works great if this data that you need to render this component is self-contained in your vertical. So I would, in case that we use that, so what we do is like we always share this information, this view model, through the message broker, and not synchronous with REST. This is something funny that we have experienced. So we basically opened the door to use new technologies, and at the beginning we, like with the first teams, they were like introducing like Apache Ignite, Apache Kafka, Zookeeper, like a lot of technologies that were a little bit of overkilling for these problems. But then they soon realized that it could be more pragmatical and we could do the same with less effort. This was a great experience for us because we didn't know how was it that we didn't have the opportunity to play with this microservice landscape. Our experience is that when you have a new team, they realize that it also helps if they use tools that are used already in our ecosystem. Even though that we don't forbid them to introduce new things, they tend to stick to things where they cannot get help from other colleagues. But at the end, the team is responsible for the development, to getting ready what the product owner needs to be done. And also, if there is some issue in production, then it's the team, so they are responsible to make it work. Some lessons that we have learned so far, so we are working around 1 year in this setup. The first lesson would be that it works. It's much faster when you have parallel teams working in different domains. The dependencies might be a problem at the beginning, so you need somebody to deal with that. So you either have like two developers like discussing with each other how to do that between two different domains, how to do the interfaces, or you have some software architect that has a little bit of overview and then defines these interfaces, this gap between them. It was a little bit of a problem for the business people to understand when they have a requirement, like which team should be doing that. We're still working with that, like trying to teach them, providing a better documentation so that they know how the whole thing works. Yeah, that's it. Like, it's working. It speed up. This works only if the business takes part of that. Okay. So one thing that we were experiencing at the beginning, so the business were not playing with us. So if we wanted to try something new, it was difficult. If you want this to work like long time, not only when you make the first version, you need to involve also the business, and then you need to have the same structure on the business as in the product teams. I would like to show you a little bit how this is done. So here you have a small overview of a few of the verticals that we have of the applications. So every application, it's usually REST API first, so we have to document the REST API. So we have we are using Swagger UI, where we document our endpoints. This would be the private API. We have done the same for the public API, the endpoints that are facing the customer. And as you see, so we have one vertical for the details, one for the navigation, one for the search, one for the content. There are many more that are not listed on this page. These are some technologies that we are using. So we are using some kind of feature flags to switch things online and offline in production or in our integration environments. We are using RabbitMQ, we are using Prometheus for monitoring, Grafana to aggregate this information from Prometheus. This is a tool to microservice to manage the stock. Greylock, it's basically this ALK stack, Elasticsearch, Logtash, Kibana, and a little bit of tooling. If we go to the product, so we can see an overview of the products that we have. Here, this would be the HTML fragment that you render for a product detail page. This is built in Vue.js. To make the server-side rendering, we have Next.js, something similar like Next.js in React. It means that the first page that you render will be always rendered by the server. It has some advantages, so it's the page speed. It's a metric that Google uses for SEO. It's basically the time that you need to render a page and then to make it usable. It's much faster if you render the first page on the server, because then you don't need to wait until the JavaScript is parsed and then interpret it, and then you render that. Here you see the product information. All this information comes through our REST API from the storage that is contained in this self-service. And if you notice here, there is no buttons. You don't see any buttons to add the product to the basket. This is like this because this information, these controls, they will be part of the checkout team. But if you look at the code, what you would find here is that using this server-side rendering, what we are printing is this include. This include renders an endpoint, in this case in our legacy system, and it prints only this formula to add the product to the basket and to the watch list for a particular product, for a particular product ID. This would be the endpoint that it would be rendered by the checkout. As you see, only the buttons that are required to add it. This would be the same endpoint after it goes through Vanish. Vanish is our integration layer in this case, the one that is putting together these chat includes. And as you can see, the buttons have been added, but only to this fragment. And if you go to what our customers see, then you would see that here it has been the whole thing integrated. So you have the old legacy system. It's a Java application with JSP, but here this has been rendered by Vue.js, by our vertical event sheet. And then this part, it's rendered thanks to another HID include that renders another endpoint. So we are composing things like this. Is like, this would be the first level of the HID include, and this would be the second level. Okay. By default, Vanish handles up to 4 levels, but you can also configure it. So far, we have a fountain use case to do more than 2 nasty levels. Okay. This is some documentation that we use to for the business guys or for the team. So it's basically the interfaces that we have, but written in some. So when you go to when you try to teach somebody using this these things, so this is something that a developer can understand very well. But when you talk to the business department, they don't get it. They cannot think of this, so it's better like to describe it a little bit with some text, okay? So that they know like what are the domain interfaces from team to team, or from vertical to vertical. This would be the mission. So this is like some snapshot of what we have. So as you see, like every team has a very focused mission. So they don't try to fix all the problems that we have. They focus only on one thing. Here you can find some of the guidelines that we were using to create our software. So one is this self-contained system architecture. So I think the authors of this website didn't invent that. It was there already, but they wrote it down and they made a good job specifying what is this about. Then some guidelines to build the front end, the back end, some guidelines, the 12-factor app manifesto, so how to make software that runs without problem being cloud native. And this is another link to go through these Microfrontends documentation. In this website, you will find that they go a little bit more into detail on the technical part, and they use a slightly different approach using web components. So web components are part of like the new generation of browsers. You can still use it in other browsers that didn't catch up yet using a polyfill. The reason that why we don't use these custom elements from these standard web components is that the server-side rendering is not that good yet. So we went for Vue.js and Next. But I think something to consider for the future. Yeah, thank you for your attention. And if you have questions, I will be happy to answer you. Yeah, so our preferred setup is 4 developers, two front-end, 2 back-end, but at the end they do like they are more or less full stack. Like we encourage the developers to pick up tickets, to pick up user stories to implement, even if they are not the best doing that, because we want to spread the knowledge, we want them to understand. We have a test automation engineer, we have a manual tester. This is something we want to go away from, but we need to invest more time in the test automation. Then you have a product owner and a agile coach. Okay, so.
How many microservices do they develop?
Yeah, so the guideline is like this self-contained system, we also call it vertical, so should belong to only one team. And one team can have one or more verticals. And then inside the vertical, they have as many microservices as they need, okay? So they usually, like the current setup is that for every vertical, you have at least 2 backend applications, one to handle the imports, to have a little bit of monitoring to check if something goes wrong, one to have the REST API, and then the part of the front end. So we have something like 3 artifacts per vertical, 3 dependent three independent deployments. But if the team wants to break it down, they can do that. For example, for the product, we are implementing a microservice to handle only the price and the availability. Okay, so it's something that it breaks down. We also are aware that one team, so ideally one team should be responsible for only one piece of software. If you split the application in too many small microservices, then you have also extra overhead to coordinate that. So we try to keep it so that it's consistent.
How do you manage the styling of the whole page remains the same?
Yeah. So for when you have this setup, you have a team, but then these teams they have every member of this team they have different strengths. Okay. For example, you have the front-end developer, back-end developer. You have also assigned somehow some designer. And these people, they have some common guidelines, okay? So there is some centralized guideline, like when you write CSS code, you have to use Vim, you have to, like, not to break other components. For the designers, it's the same. So the designers have some corporative identity style, and then they are responsible for following that, okay? So basically, it's not organizing the team, so basically, the boss of this designer is maybe the one that is deciding the look and feel for the whole project or all the projects in Little Digital, and he's in charge of saying, okay, so a button should look like this. Okay, this is how it works. Okay, it might happen that we implement the button twice, but these guidelines they are across the company, and they are responsible. We are responsible to follow up that. Yeah, so every application should be somehow highly available, okay? So we are using the common OpenShift Kubernetes approaches. For example, okay, at the storage level, we have always a cluster. We have either a MySQL cluster or we have a Redis cluster. So we do that at this level, like this small cluster for one domain, and then for the backend application, so we will have something like a blue-green deployment or some rolling deployment where you have at the same time applications running from two different versions, and then you are like shutting down one application and then creating a new one. We have also some load balancer on the top, and this load balancer checks also for all the instances for a particular domain, and if some node it's not healthy, then it takes it out from the load balancing. So this would be the way we do that. We don't have anything like a big infrastructure teams that take care of that. Every team knows that the application have to be running the whole time, and this is how we do it. Yeah, that's a very good question. So at the moment, so we have in the legacy system we have jQuery as a framework, and then we use Vue.js for the new verticals. Okay. In the ideal case, when you load the page, you should load only one bundle of the JavaScript CSS, and this is handled by Nuxt, by Webpack, so it should be okay. Okay. We have measured it. There is some overhead. The overhead is not so much in the rendering part, because when you render a page, the page provides the HTML and the CSS. The browser can render that, but you also render the thing for this Vue.js application, and this requires the browser to parse the JavaScript. Even if no function is invoked, you have to parse the JavaScript, and this is extra overhead that makes it a little bit slower to to the customer. Okay, so the problem is not so much how big it is. The problem is the overhead that you have when you are rendering CSS or JavaScript. So yeah. At the moment, it's only one application, one framework. It's okay.
Yeah. So the Angular, React, and Vue.
There was an example.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.